Okay, good morning class, and it's 11 o'clock now. Please go to Spectrum to record your attendance. Once it is done, some students respond to me. Okay, okay. So if the password is working and you're already done with attendance, you can leave a message in chat so that we can start the class. Thanks for the reply. I will start the recording now. Good morning, class. Today we will continue the next lecture, which is focused on CSS. So in these lectures, I have shared two lecture notes. One is to introduce you with the basic CSS. Another lecture notes is related to some guidance on the how we can start structure the layout of page layout using CSS. So first we will start from the basic of CSS. So in this lecture notes we will look at how to define CSS, how you can actually apply different CSS properties to configure color, text, and what are the commonly used selectors or the how we can actually, what kind of styles that we can apply to some of the examples of the elements. So first of all, when we talk about CSS, in the first lecture, I already mentioned that CSS is like the adjective of the web page. So when we talk about style sheets, we can see like, for example, in our desktop publishing applications like Microsoft Word, they actually can allow us to apply different type of typographical styles and spacing to our documents. So basically, the concept of CSS is similar to that. It provides the functionality of style sheets and much more. And also it is a flexible cross-platform standards-based language developed by W3 schools. So if you look at the example for this, CSS Zen Garden. So when we learn HTML, right, we are focusing on the structure. So before we add CSS, when we use HTML, our main purpose is to know what are the structure of the web page and what are the main some of the content that we want to put in this web page. So when we add CSS, it actually allow us to make the to add the adjective to make the web page looks more attractive, look nicer with images, with different font types, with different styles. So if you click the link for CSS Zen Garden, so this is the page. They give you some ideas. This is just something to share with you. So this is actually designed by some practitioners to show us the beauty of CSS. So you can also click here to view all design. When we want to apply CSS, there are some rules that you need, some syntax rules that we need to apply. So style sheets basically is a combination of rules that describe the styling that we will apply to this web page. So when we want to define the rules, we have to choose the selector. This is actually the way how we will write it. The selector represent the elements that we want to select to apply the style. So normally selector, for example, the selector can be body. So I remember when we write the HTML code, also there are some students that will ask me, can we just omit the body? But normally body sections is the one of the main element to show this is the main web content that will be displayed to the users. So for example, in this example, body elements is selected, and we properties, they are different for every element, right? There are different properties that we can select to define values to it. So for example, one of the common properties that we use on styling is we want to decide what is the color that we are going to use for our website. So let's say if in this example, we select the body element. So we know that the whole web page, we want to make some changes to it using some colors. So the property that we select is color and the value is blue. So we knew that the whole page will actually the colors that we are going to use, the font colors will be blue color. This apply to the whole web page content. So we can also add a few different, we can add different properties to it. So these are some other examples. For example, we can have H1 is the heading element. And in this example, we want to use the font color purple. If we only put color, like it refers to font color. If background color will be, the property name is BG color. So when we see only color, that means it is the font color, refer to the font color. We can specify the value of the color that we want to define to this property. And another example, the font size is 56 pixels. And this is another example. So for all the IMG, for all the images, we want to set to have the border color, red color, and border width is 3 pixels. So if you want to know more about CSS, you can click this link to go to the Mozilla developer website. They give you a lot of guidelines on how, and also some tutorials, how you can tutorials to learn the CSS, and also how to use the CSS layout, building blocks, this and that. So they give you some guidelines. So one of the reason is because there are a lot of properties for that you can actually apply values to it. So it's quite impossible for you to memorize everything. So whenever you want to apply something, or you are not sure what properties we can use for the particular element, you can actually search online. You can Google it or go to the Mozilla website or W3 schools. They will give you some examples or the set of properties that you can use for this particular element. So one of the reason why we are using CSS, because you remember when we started to do the lab, normally we will have for a typical website, you are not only having a home page. Normally, you will have more than one page. So in this example, if you see in this diagram, we have that there are four pages in this website: index, product page, about page, and contact page. And when we have multiple web pages, how are we going to standardize the styles? If we are going to add styles in each, this is very difficult we want to make changes to one page, we have to make changes to all the pages, right? Because a lot of time, if you see a lot of website, they actually have standard design. Even for FSKTN website, you can see actually, or they will have the same styles. When you go to navigate to other page also, you will feel that they are the reasons why they are using, we will standardize the styles is when anyone want to visit any website, they know they are actually still in the same website. We want to give people the standardized view on the website that we are using. So normally we apply the same styles to all the pages in the same website. So since there are multiple web pages, and if we want to standardize the style, it will be good that we have a single CSS file that can control the color, the typography, and layout of the web pages. When we want to make changes, we just work on the CSS file. So it is actually a very these are some of the advantages. We have greater control on the typography, on page layout. We can also separate the style from the structures. We can focus on structure using HTML, and to make changes to the styles, to make our to add the adjective to our website, we separate it from the structure, and this can be stored in a separate document. We can have a separate CSS file and then link it to our web page, let the web page link to the this style sheet. And it is also a smaller document when we have a separate style sheet, and it also easier for us to maintain it. When let's say your companies want to do rebranding, and now maybe the companies want to change some of their brand logo or certain things, we just need to update it on the style sheet, and the changes apply to all the web pages on the website. There are four different ways that you can include CSS in your web page. If you look at this in these two slides, they show you there are four different ways you can do it. But of course, we will try to apply use the best practice in our website so that it is easier for us to maintain. So if you see for inline style, we can actually include the style, choose the style that we want to decide. For example, you can decide in which element, for example, in body sections or which element that you want to apply the style. We can include the HTML element with the property style and the value. So later we will look at the example for inline styles so that you can understand what it means by inline style. And we can also have what we call embedded styles. Embedded styles means that you embed the styles in the head section. So remember, in our website, right, we have two parts, head sections and also body section. Head section is normally is the meta informations and is also invisible to the user. So another way that you can include your styles is you can put it all under the head section, and this will apply to the entire web page, on this web page only. For external styles, that means that we have a separate text file and save it as .css file extension. And inside this file, we can include all the HTML elements that we want to apply the style rules. So normally how we associate the CSS file is we will include a HTML link element inside the head section. So we don't need to, separate CSS files, we only include all the rules. We don't need to include any HTML text, only specific for the CSS, all the styles that we want to apply to, to the whole website. So another, this is the separate file. Later, we also will show you the example later in the coding. The last one is imported styles. The concept is similar to external styles, but we import style rules from other style sheets. Like for example, like bootstraps. Or sometimes you may also notice that some people, they will use some what we call web font styles, like Google fonts or some other font style. All these bootstrap, they already have their own CSS file, and we can just import their styles and apply to our website. That means we don't have to we don't have to start from scratch, but we can actually just pick the external style sheet that we think that is suitable for our website and use it and import it and use it. Okay. So this is the sample code. Okay, I'll show you later. I'll show the Visual Studio. This part is just the more like the theory part. For inline, in your HTML page, in your HTML, you include the rules as an inline CSS. That means that after the name of the element, like H3, you put the style equals to color is the property, pink is the value. So that means that you specify what is the CSS style that you want to apply to this element straight away in the inline. But of course, there is also the problem if, let's say, you have different web pages in a website, then you will find that it is difficult for you to make changes. When you change this, you also have to apply changes to all the websites. So this is CSS allow you to do inline CSS, but of course, it is not a very good practice. Another one, like what I mentioned earlier, we can also include CSS styles as an embedded style. Means that we add the CSS under the head section in the web page. So, but we the way how we write it, we will put style opening tag for style and slash style. So this is the tagging style and also ending style. So type equals to we need to specify what is the type of this style. So in this example, we have since it is CSS, so we have to put text slash CSS. Then you can include all the rules under here within the opening and closing style tag. So in this example, we can see that this is the list item. This is we indicate that in this list item, we want to use the font color red. We want to use the red font color. But as I mentioned earlier, this is a bad idea because once we want to make changes to if there are any changes, we have to make the changes to all the website, all the web pages in the website. So that's why the best practice is always that we have a separate CSS file, then we link it. We use the HTML link element to link to refer to the files that we have. We had for the CSS to refer to the CSS file name. So you can see that this is the standard way to include the CSS file. You put the this is the which indicate that this is a style sheet and the type is CSS, and this is the encode reference to refer to the app.css, the link. What is the link reference? We want to indicate this is the app, this is the name of the file with the extension.css. So this is actually a better way for us to include a CSS in a separate file. Now I will show you in the if you open the HTML the sample code for CSS, you can see that under here there are two. If before you unzip, these are some other examples that I had. So if you look at the this example CSS inline embedded, this basically just give you some example. So you can see this is the example for embedded. Under the head sections, we embed the styles in the head section. So this is one of the way that we can include CSS. So remember to put type equals to CSS. So within here, you can put anything that you like. And we can also have inline CSS. Inline CSS means that you straight away put the style within the element. Within the element, in line with the element. So this is the way how we write it. The indicate this is the style. Specify this is the style. What is the property and the value? So if I open this, you can see we already know that H3 will use a pink color and paragraph we will use the yellow color. So you can see in this example, if we compare to the code that we had. In the embedding size, we know that the list item will be, the font colors will be red. So if you see here, this is the part relevant to this style sheet. If we scroll down under the inline example, we have the two H3 using pink color, font color pink color, and this paragraph will use the yellow color. So this is the two ways that you can use. But it is not recommended to use embedded or inline. The best way is to have a separate CSS file. So in the separate CSS file, right, you don't include any HTML code. You only include the rules, like the style rules that you want to define in this file. So you can see in this app.css file, we have a few different, we have a few examples of different types of the elements that we are going to different types of, we have select different elements that we want to apply styles to it, and some of the example property and the value that we define. So this, if and to include it, So this is the one that I just I already show you. We embed it. We refer the link inside the head section as well. Refer to the file name. So remember, this is the standard way how you refer to an external CSS. So once we refer to it, so we know that in this HTML code, we don't need to have any inline or embedded CSS anymore. We just need to, we know that all the changes that we indicate here, all the styles that we indicate here will be applied automatically to this website. So in this example, we know that the all the elements with the H1, the font color will be purple. For H3, will be pink color. So if we scroll down, we can look at the H1 and H3 element. So this one, we know the colors will be purple. For H3 one, we know we later we will see in a pink color. So if you open this, so this is the one that we can see. H1, purple color. H3, pink color. So whatever changes that we have, whatever rules that we have defined, style rules that we define here, will be reflect here. So these are some other examples. So later, you will notice that we have hash and also dot here. So this actually represent the ID and also class. I will explain this later in the next few slides. We will come to the how to indicate ID and also class. So this is just to show you. So if let's say now if you want to include other elements like let's say you want to have H2 to you want to also define H2. So just follow the rules how we normally define the syntax rule how we define the style. So let's say for H2 we want to change, we also want to indicate a color, and for this one we want to use blue color, for example. So you can see for Visual Studio Code, they also give you some hints and show you some colors. So let's say if you choose blue, then they also will try to show you the color. And if I refresh the page again, yeah, you can see the H2 has changed to blue color. So this is just quickly shows you the how it works. So we can have include multiple property and values here for this particular to make changes to these particular elements. So even if you want to make if you include other properties, then you can actually see more changes to the H2 elements. The common formatting that we normally use in CSS these are some of the common CSS properties that we always use for most of the elements. Will HTML elements will support these properties. For example, background color, font family, font size, font style, font weight, line height, margin, text align, text decoration, and width. These are some of the commonly used CSS properties that people like to used to configure the styles. So this is some of the color codes. So this, if you see this in this example, there are also different kind of color charts. Sometimes they also will recommend to you what are the colors that is suitable for web applications. So this is just to show you some examples. So to configure color with built-in colors, so you can see this is the original HTML. And we can actually add colors to it, like what we have I have shown you earlier in the Visual Studio Code. Like in this example, in the HTML file, this is the structure and also the content of our of this web page. In the CSS file, we can configure the color using the color property and indicate the value of this color that we want to have, and this will be the outcome. So this next few slides will show you some of the examples of the formatting that we can apply in CSS and how it will look like. So this is besides using sometimes we can use the built-in colors, like these are the common one, we can straight away use the name, like red, cornflower, blue, dark, orchid. But we can also use the hexadecimal color values. Of course, if you don't know the hexadecimal color values for the color that you want to use, you can search online. There are a lot of color chart. If you search online for the hexadecimal color values chart, they will give you the selections when you select the color. Then they will allow you to click and you will get the code that you want. So normally for hexadecimal, the color code will be start from hash with the 6 hexadecimal numbers from 0 to F. We can also use RGB color values. They also allow us to use the RGB. So in this RGB, we have the you can also search online to get the RGB color code. So normally RGB, they include the red, it's actually using 3 channels, red, green, and blue. So they are every channels have the range from 0 to 255. So different combinations of the color code will give you different colors. So for example, in the first one, 0, 255, 0 will give you this kind of green color. So to know the code also, you can go to website to search for RGB color. You pick the color that you want, then you can see the color values. So this is another one, RGBA. Color chart that you can apply is the RGBA color values. A indicate the alpha or transparency channel. So you can see there are a bit of transparency adding to it. And the transparency range from 0.0 to 1.0. So when we use color to indicate the text color, for background, we will use the property name background. So when we see background, right, this indicate the background color. When we see color, it indicate the text color. So this is the difference. Sometimes students will mix up. They thought color is for the background, but actually color is indicate the text color. And background refers to the background color. So if you see this example, in the whole body sections, we have background color. This is the color code. So we can see this looks like the gray color. We also have a division in this website. So within this division, we have specified the background color, which is from the blue color family. For the text in the paragraph, so there are 2 paragraphs here, but both also, when we have separate style sheets, when we define the property color here, it will apply to the whole web page. So this color, this is looks like the white color, looks like something like similar to the white color for this text color. So you can see this is one example in the CSS. We have configured color for body, background color for body, background color for this division, and also text color for the paragraph. So because making a good color choices is quite important. Especially when you do a design, we want to make sure that the color that we choose are reasonable. So my advice is, if you are someone that, especially if you are someone that you are not too sure about how to choose a good color, you can refer to some of the website. Doesn't limit to the one that I put here. There are a lot of websites that actually give you some guidelines, and also you can also Google to get some advice how to choose color. So you can see here. So sometimes we can actually indicate different colors that we want to see. They can also allow you to do some different combinations. There are a lot of websites that actually allow you to choose to have a look at how you can do the color code. You can also do some searching on the colors, this and that. Doesn't limit to here. There are a lot of websites that actually give you examples on that. Okay, so this is also another example. So even you are interested in like, let's say you want to apply LGBA, you are not sure which color code to use, also you can just Google the, if you Google LGBA also, there are a lot of there are a lot of tutorials that also will be given to you on the LGBA. You can also search, you can also refer to what are the LGBA colors and how you should write it, and there are a lot of examples to show you. So choosing color is important for your website, because if you choose the appropriate one when people visit your website, they will feel like your website is not professional. If you choose some odd color, especially if your you are designing a website for a company, and the company is a professional company, maybe they are providing services that computing services that are professional. So if you design for this kind of company, a more serious company, of course the color that you choose will be something like more professional, that give people some professional look. But on the other hand, if let's say you are designing a website for a game application website, so sometimes maybe the color choice that you use will be different again. So that's why if you are not sure what color to use, my advice is you actually can go online to search for some, to look at some tutorial and get some ideas how to choose the colors, especially like let's say you want to decide color for your background, color for the heading, color for the header part, color for the footer part, what is the good combinations of different colors that we can use in our website. Okay, so next we will look at some examples for how to configure text. For text, there are properties like the font weight to decide the boldness. We can also decide the font style, like for example, italics, size, and what font family we want to use. So these are some other text properties and the meanings of the text properties. This is the some examples to show you on using the values, indicate the values in text. So these are some example. If you want extra small, you can put X small and extra large. This is how, these are just some example. We can also use EM units, PX units, PT units, and percentage to indicate the size. So the way how we indicate values for CSS, sometimes some of the properties, they will allow multiple ways for you to configure the values. So you can actually understand more and also know that when you use PT, so what is the outcome, what is the result that you will get? So even if you're not sure, you can always try it. Like let's say now, if you want to try to get some of the size, you can actually just try it on the CSS and run your web page to execute your web page to have a look at the result if you are not sure. So for font family also, sometimes for some of the website, you will notice that they include more than one font name. So they will include multiple, but they are actually, because sometimes there will be some issues, some of the end user at the client side, not all the computer have the same fonts installed, especially when your OS is different. Sometimes maybe this OS, they don't support the font family that you use in your website. So to be safe, like for example, for the font family category for series one, these are all the font typeface, the name of the font typeface under the serif family. For sans serif, these are the font typeface. For monospace, these are the font typeface. For cursive, for fantasies, these are the font typeface. So sometimes to make sure that to avoid the problem that when the user open your website, they cannot shows the styles correctly, we can actually include more than one. We can include more than one font typeface, so that in case even if this is not installed, they can use the others in the list. So normally we will configure a list of fonts and include a generic include a generic family name. So we can see from here, we include the font typeface Arial and Verdana, and also their family name Sans Serif. We indicate the font family. The letter, just now, so far, whatever example that I show you, right? We say that when we want to define rules for CSS style, we have to use the selectors in our format. This is what we call selector. So selector, they are different selectors can be configured. The most straightforward one is the HTML element name, like what I have shown you just now. Like H1 is the HTML element name, H1 for heading, H2, H3, div for division. But there are also other patterns that we can use for selector. For example, ID and class, and also descendant. The first one you already know. I will further explain on this, the next three. Okay, this one we already know. If we are using HTML element selector, that means we just use the HTML name, and this will apply to all the division, all the pages, all the paragraph in this web page. But for certain time, right? Sometimes we only want to apply the style on one thing on the website only. For example, we know that in this website, like if you see this example, I have a few paragraphs here, but only this spatial paragraph, I want to apply the style. The other P, I don't want to apply this style. So if you only want to select only one element, you can use the ID. You can specify your own ID, your own ID name. This is what I mean, your own ID name. And this will only apply to one this can be applied to one per page when we use ID. So you can see in this example, for this particular element, I indicate the ID equals to spatial. So this is the way how we write it. In the HTML, we specify which element I want to apply style, some spatial style to it. So ID equal the name, you can change it to any name that you like. But something meaningful that you can reflect what you want to do. Like in this example, we know we have an ID, we have defined an ID for this element called spatial. So we can indicate in CSS what to configure the format that we like. So in this example, we have seen that for this particular element, I configure color, yellow colors for this paragraph. That means the text will appear as yellow color. If you look at this, there are four paragraphs here, right? But only this one with the ID that I define will appear as yellow color. The rest will use the default paragraph colors, text color. So if we come when you want to use ID, right, make sure you have to put hash in front of it for ID to indicate this is an ID in CSS. But in HTML, you put ID equals to, then you use the, you indicate the name, the name using string. Plus, if let's say you have more than one element that you want to apply the style, you can use the class selector. Class selector, that means that you have a group of elements that you want to apply the style to it. So you put class, you give a class name to group all the elements that you want to apply the style to it. So for example, in this example, we know that these two elements have a class name called highlight. So we will apply style to the highlight. And when we want to indicate it inside the CSS, in HTML, what you put is class equals to the name of the class. For ID, is ID equals to refer to the class of the name. But as to separate the class element from the ID, in CSS, you will have a dot in front of the class name. Then you can put what the properties, list down the properties that you want to configure and also define the values to this property. So if we see this example, we know that these two paragraph we have defined yellow background color. Okay, so you can see in these two. So there are four paragraphs here, but only these two will be highlighted in yellow colors. So this is just to give you some example, but the whole division, you can also see this is the DIV applied to the whole HTML element, but only these two, we have defined separate class to apply specific changes to it, to have background color, to have yellow background color. The next selector is what we call descendant. That means that we can also have like a parent and child. That means that we can have a descendant or the child. We can be more specific to select an element within the context of its container elements. So if you look at this in this CSS, we have two, you have see two elements here. P, DIV and P. The first one indicate the parent. The second one indicate the child or the descendant. So if you look at here, we know that although in this HTML we have so many paragraphs, but only the one that nested within the division will apply the style. We only apply style for the paragraph background color only for those that nested inside the DIV. So the first one, it will be the parent. The second one will be the child element. So when we see the changes of the style, we know that only these four will be highlighted in yellow background color. Okay. So this is just to remind you, if you have more than one element on a page that you want to apply changes, it is recommended to use class. And remember, when you write it in the style sheet, you have to put dot in front of the class name. For if you only want to apply to one element, then you can use ID. You can indicate, you can specify an ID name to the elements in the HTML page. Then inside your CSS, you use hash notation. So if this is the example, so now if you look at here, in this file, if you scroll down, okay, you can see that we have ID equal to spatial here. So I know that this paragraph have a spatial, have an ID called spatial, and in the app.css we can check what is the styles that we have defined. Okay, so for ID equals to spatial, that means we have to look for the name spatial, and when we write it right, you have to put hash in front of it. And in this example, we know we have configured red color to this paragraph. And you also can see there is a class called equals to highlight for this paragraph. There are also other class names like class equals to style 1, class equals to style 2, class equals to style 3. And this can be, you can actually apply this to more than one element. So you can see here we have a class called highlight with the background green color. We also have a class called company name. Yeah, I think we don't have it. I will add it to show it as an example. So we can see there are a few things that we can see here, like this is indicate, if you see dot, that means this is a class name. If you see, that in this example, we have seen that this is what we have a dot style 2, style 1, style 2, and style 3. Okay, we also have some descendant. So under navigations, so this is the one specifically we want to put the unordered list when we apply styles to the navigation. If you go to navigation, so under navigations, we have this, we have also a nested child element and within the navigation. So we know this style only apply to the unordered list within the navigation. Then the anchor tag within the navigation, so only apply to this. So this is how you should you when you go through, even if you download some sample CSS file from other from some website as a reference, you have to understand how people have write CSS so that you know how what are the elements that they have actually used, or are the elements that they have applied styles, and what are the ID or specific class name that they have. So if you look at the example again, you will see these are a lot, these are some of the changes that we can see from the. So if you see for highlight, the background is green color. So we can see this is the one that with the green color. So there are also some classes that have that we can apply in this website, since we have import the external, we have include the external CSS file. So all the styles here actually can be applied to this web page. So you are clear, right? If let's say you have more than one element, then you use class, you define a class name. And they can also be different HTML types. That means that if you have different class, right, you can also use it, like let's say not only for paragraph, it may be another one, you use it for another HTML element, but they will use the same class name, but you apply the same background color to it. And the next few slides will show you just some of the common one. So we can also use the span element to only indicate specified a specific or small area that we want to format. So it's, for example, in this example, we use a span with a, we also define a class name, like company name, to indicate the changes that we want. So if you see in this CSS, just now we have seen something, this is a class name that we use for this span element, HTML span element, and this will make changes to, this will indicate the changes to it. I'll add this into and I refresh the changes. Just now I added this. I copy and paste here just to add to the demo file. So we have you can see here, we have a class company name. Now I include a paragraph with the company name, use the span elements, and this is the class name that I defined for this style. When I refresh it, I can see the changes here. Only this particular, the company name, will apply the changes. So sometimes we can also use span is also one of the useful elements if we only want to indicate some only for a specific part. We can also have horizontal rule to add some styles. HR horizontal rule basically will give you a horizontal line to to separate some of the to break down the paragraph between paragraph level elements. So you can see here, this is an example. We put a horizontal rule element here to separate the content and the footer. So this is the horizontal rule. For horizontal rule, there are some properties that you can apply, that the border top to indicate that you want to have a border. What is the values that you want to indicate and colors. So there are different styles that properties that you can apply for the horizontal line. If you see here, we have a few horizontal rules, right? And you can see that in the code in the CSS file, there are three different examples with the style 1, style 2, and style 3, the three class name, to show use like with double, solid line, and dash lines. And okay, so there are different properties you can use for horizontal line as well. For background image, to include background image, because sometimes you see a lot of website, they instead of using background color, they also include background image that they have that they prepare for the website. To include background image, if it is an external file, then you can indicate using URL. You use the same property background, but you include it as the URL. The value you put URL and put bracket to include the URL name. Another one, if let's say you have the file, the image file, put inside the same project folder. Like if you have a background, you save it in your project folder, background1.gif, then you just indicate, you don't need to put the HTTP, you just put the file name. But also need to include the URL. You have to use the, when you indicate the value, include the URL. So these are some background image property that you can use. We can use the background repeat property. So this is the example, repeat y, we will repeat the image multiple times as the y-axis, x-axis, or no repeat. If no repeat, that means they only appear one time. If you use the no repeat. Okay, so this is the example when we have in this website, they have a image trigger bullet. So this is included as a background image, and they are with no repeat. So it only appear one time. So this is another example, trillionfoot.gif, no repeat button, and appear at the position it at the bottom right. So you can see sometimes we have different example. This is some examples to show you how people have applied the background images using different properties. Well, if you want to debug CSS, if you yourself sometimes after you apply, right, like for example just now, you can see that when I apply this, it doesn't work. Why? Because this is the wrong syntax. Because sometimes when we copy and paste from the file, you have to check it to retype it so that the text editor will recognize this as a file name. So if let's say sometimes you have your file, you have a long list of CSS, but when you run the file, you notice that there are some mistakes. The style that you plan to apply doesn't appear. So you will see that how come it doesn't work, and you feel that when you, after checking a few times, you still couldn't find out what is the problem. So there is also a what we call CSS validator provided. You can actually just upload the file to it to let the validator do the checking for you. You can do the file upload, or you can copy and paste the CSS file for you to validate. So this is actually one of the quick way, because a lot of time, right, when we configure styles, we will have more than a lot, a long list. If you download, if you download an external CSS file, for example, from Bootstrap, you will, when you open the file, you will notice that there is a very long CSS CSS file with a lot of rules included, for style rules included in the file. If you make a mistake, right, sometimes very difficult for us to check. This is one of the way that you can do the checking. So this is for the part one, the basics. Any questions that you want to ask on CSS, I will take a 5 minutes break later before I continue the second part for the layouts. For the first part, basically, I just show you some example, and you make sure that you understand how to, the rules. The important thing is you need to know the way how we can define CSS, follow the right way, the general rule. And we also can, there are two things that I'd like to highlight is, we can also indicate our own ID name and class name. So for ID, remember, is hash. For class, is dot. So inside your CSS file, you can indicate the class with the name, with an appropriate class name, and this can apply to multiple elements. If you only want to refer to one particular element to make some special style, you use ID and give a appropriate ID name. But here you put hash to indicate ID, dot to indicate class. So anything you want to ask before I take a 5 minutes break, anything that you are not clear, or anything you want to ask for CSS? Clear, right? Not nothing, right? So you can, all clear, okay, that's good. So I will take a 5 minutes break before I continue the second part related to the layouts. So we will have five minutes break first, then I'll continue. Okay, class, I will continue the second part of this lecture. The second part will focus on the how to use CSS to design the layout for our website. So before we look at how to design, for example, like two column or three column page layouts, there are some of the concepts that I need to explain to you first. One of the important concepts is the concept of what we call box model, and how we can configure the margin, floor, or and some of the properties that will allow us to do the layout. One of the important concepts that when we apply the layout in using the CSS is the concept of box model. As defined in MDN, box model is what we mean in a document. In a document, right, each of the element is represented as a rectangular box. So we assume that every element, it is actually put within a rectangular box. In CSS, each of these rectangular boxes is described using the standard box model. So if each box has four edges, the margin edge, border edge, padding edge, and content edge. So this is actually an important concept of the box model. We know it is rectangular, and we can also configure the margin, border, padding, and contents. So this slide shows you in the box model, we know that every element is represented as a rectangular box. So since it is a rectangular box, remember there will be four parts: the top, right, bottom, and left. So remember this, because sometimes when you see, when you configure some of the your margin, border, or padding, you will see you put margin top, margin right. So only to a specific part of this edge. So in this, in the box model, we know the main content that we are going to display in the website. Inside this box model, the middle part is the content, which is the text and web page elements in the container. So outside the content, we can actually configure padding area. So which is the area between the content and also border. I think border, we should know it. Sometimes in for some of the elements, we will specify we want to have border. And the border can be solid line, can be dashed line, this and that. So border will help us to separate between the padding and the margin. So for margin basically will allow us to have some empty space between this element and the adjacent elements near to it. So let's say if maybe I have one element here and another element here. So if I define margin value to indicate some empty space between this element to another, to the element near to it. So remember, so you have to remember this edge element, so this edge property, so that you know that when you define it, what you are trying to define. So the middle part is the main content, the text and web page elements content in the container. So the container that we apply, the concept is the box model. So we know for this particular element, you can actually define padding, the area between the content and border. We can also configure border. We can also have some empty space using the margin. So to configure margin, there are four properties actually: margin top, right, left, and bottom. Like what I show you, top, right, left, bottom. You can configure, this is for us to configure the empty space between this element and the element near to it. So the syntax is, these are some syntax example, okay? So but you can double check, because I also can't remember which, if let's say we only put two, which one that indicates. So you can actually go online to double check what is, if we put two, which one we are indicating? Is it only the first two? Okay, so if you indicate this is they allow us to indicate the what is the space that we want to have. So this in this example, they use pixels to specify the empty space that we want to have between the elements and the adjacent elements. For paddings also, we can have top, right, left, bottom. Okay, so you, with the value, we can indicate numeric values or percentage, same as this one, numeric values or percentages. Border, we can also have a border. Let's say in this is a H2, heading 2. So the main content of this is will be a heading. So we decide that we want to have a border for this H2 elements, so we indicate this is the border and what we want to have it, the border, the size of the border will be 2 pixels and we want it to start it as a solid line. And this is indicate the colors of the border, which is red color. So we can, for this property, we can indicate the border with 2 pixels, border style, solid, in solid line, border color. FF000. So this one, they will recognize it as the width, style and color. So this is another. This is to show you the example. For we have a H2 with border, and also an anchor tag also has a border. So this is the browser. This when we have a use different browser, right? Sometimes the way how they will apply the for example like border, right? They will appear a bit different, but it depends on which browser that you use. But of course, although the display a bit different, but it will still show as a dash line. But just sometimes maybe the way how they show dash is looks a bit different. But it still will reflect the same thing, like dotted. Also, sometimes it may be Firefox, you will see the dotted will be a bit different. So you can always configure a specific size of a border, like what I mentioned, that we can also have only border bottom. If let's say we have, because border normally, if you didn't indicate anything, you only say border, they assume you want to include a border for top, right, left, and bottom. But if you only want to include what shows the border line for bottom part, then you indicate border bottom, and the width is 2 pixels, solid line, color is red. So you can also decide only one side only. So this is one just to show you a screenshot with the border box, border box model example, box model concept. So you can see in this one, we can see that this is the whole body sections to show all the web content. So we have margin here, specified margin here. If we didn't specify margin, right, your elements will stretch to the end. But sometimes we want everything to look nicer, then we will indicate margin empty space within the body sections. So you can see this is another example for heading. In this heading element, we specify a border, solid line border. We also specify padding, some area between the main content and the border. We have padding as well. So this text is the main content of the heading. Padding space, we have border, line, and also we have indicate margin. So this margin creates space between this and another paragraph. So in this paragraph, again, we can see we have margin, indicate margin, and this is the main content. We also have a border, the black color border, which has a bigger width size as compared to the first one. So far this one, the box model concept, you can understand, right? Because this is actually quite important when we especially when we want to design the layout, and want to make our website looks nicer, we will indicate some margin padding, but you need to know padding refer to what, margin refer to what, so that you put the right space or right area to make your website looks nicer. Okay, we can also apply what we call box size sizing property. So this is actually we can have some we will have default value for width or height. Is the value for only the contents, not including border and padding. We can apply what we call box sizing property used to selector to direct the browser to calculate the width and height of an element to include the value for content, padding, and border. So if let's say we apply the box sizing property, we can use the use a universal selector asterisk. This will indicate that we will apply this to all the elements on the page. Like for example, in this example for box sizing, we have indicated the border box. So this apply to all the elements on the page. So this is another example to show you. Browser normally displays the elements in order. So let's say if you call it, you call this first, then it will appear before the second box. But if you put this box, this element within another element, it will actually put it as a inside this outer box. That means this is more like a parent element if we put within the tagging. So you can see if let's say this is a paragraph, I have a big a nested paragraph within this, but it can appear even if you indicate border, it will shows like two boxes. One is the outer box, one is inner box. If we put as a separate paragraph, I have this as a first paragraph and the second one as a second division or paragraph. So we can see normally they follow the order, how you code it in the HTML. So there are also some of the property that we can apply so that we can position some of the elements. So you can see sometimes you will see some website, you can see that the property or the elements, they will actually stick to the right side or left side on the browser, on the browser window. And one of the property that you can actually apply is the float property. They will allow, if you say float to the right, it will actually float to the right side of a web browser. If you put float to the left, it will actually push the elements to the left side of the browser. So if you see in this example, we have a picture. This is a picture with the ID YLS. So in this image, you can see in the CSS, right, they have applied the float property in this element to float it, the image, to the right side. And this element, they also have indicate the margin space and the border, and also add a border with 1 pixel border with solid line black color. So this is one of the useful property you can use in the element to sometimes to put some show some of the float positions. Clear property also useful when you want to clear or terminate a float. You can indicate like you want to clear the left side, right side, or both. So you can also go online to search more to look at other examples. So in this example, we can see when we have clear left apply to the H2. So the initial one, the H2 display in the normal follow the order. The picture float to the right side, then we have we have one paragraph and we have one H2. So if in the normal one, if you didn't indicate the clear property, you will see it actually appear here. But if when we put clear left, apply to the H2, it actually display the H2 text after the floated image to clear or terminate a float in this element. So it will look different now. So another property that you can use is overflow property, and this is to intended to configure the display of the elements on the web page. So the values that you can it is useful to clear or to terminate a float before the end of a container element. So the overflow can we can use the value auto, hidden, and scroll. So if you see this example, the background does not extend. In the original one, this only indicate to specify to this box with the background color. So in the and in this example, they have applied overflow auto to the division, to the whole division, to this division. And now we can see the background extends and the H2 display after the float image. So this actually align with the float image and extend the background color after they apply the auto for flow, the overflow to auto. So these are just some examples, and you can actually go online to search more examples on these three properties: float, clear, and overflow. They are commonly used to sometimes to indicate some of the layout or the positions to clear or terminate the float. Okay, so last week we have learned the HTML5 structural elements. So we can see in HTML we have some structural elements like header, main, navigation, and these also can be supported in the CSS. So for example, in this example, we have include these structural elements: header, main, navigation, footer, section, article, figure caption aside. All we want it to display in using the box model, the block display as a block. So this is one of the if let's say you have some compatibility issues with HTML5, you worry that there are some issues. Maybe some people they are using old laptop or old computers, so their browsers already cannot be upgraded to the latest version of the browser, so they are using older browser. And if you worry about the compatibility issues, you can actually indicate this to support the compatibility, to have a same effect for HTML, like the HTML5. So this is also one of the script that you include to in order to get the HTML5 compatibility. So this is the one that we have last time. We have seen the just refresh your memory. So this is the header. We can have navigations to indicate the navigation menu with the navigation links to other web pages. This will indicate the main element. So hope you still remember the structural name for each element. So this is the main, and we can also have a footer element here. So these are the four common HTML structural elements: header, main, navigation, and footer. So of course we also have some other element like a site section that you can use, article and time element. You can go online to look at some examples for this. For page layout, right, one of the things that you can see some website, right, they only have a single column, but some they you can also see some of the website they actually allow you to create two columns. Sometimes also make possible to be three columns. So if you see, this is one of the example that we have seen. We have a single column wireframe. And you can see that you have seen one thing, right? What I call wrapper. So the meaning of wrapper is it is actually commonly used to center a layout on the page. We keeps a layout from having too wide or too narrow. So we actually use wrapper to indicate it in the layout. So because actually if you are using different laptop or different or you open the website in your mobile phone, they have actually different what we call different device viewport. Device viewport means that user can view the visible area of a web page will be different from device to device. That's why sometimes we consider that we wrap everything. We call it wrapper to wrap everything inside in the in the we indicate everything is in the layout. We wrap everything of the elements in this layout. So then inside this we have the structural elements like header, navigation, main, and footer. So if you see this sample wireframe, the assume this whole thing, we wrap all the elements in as a center content. So this is another example for two column. They convert from this single column to two column. So in this two column, the navigation is not put after the header. It's put on the left side. After the header, we have navigations appear on the left and main content appear on the right. And then after that, we have the footer here. So this is one of the design for two column. So for basic two columns, right, it's common in web layout is we will normally, the two column normally is to separate the navigation sections and also main sections. They will be side by side, like one column for navigation, one column for main. So this is depends on how you want to design your website. And some of the website, like if you see a lot of dashboard, right, they like to use two column. Left side shows all the navigations to navigate to different links in this dashboard, and this will show the main content of the dashboard, for example. So this is one of the example code that just for your reference, if you see this basic two column layout, this is how it looks like. We have header here, left have a left navigation column and the right content column. So you can see from here that we have indicated the wrapper. In this wrapper, we assume that the whole things, we indicate an ID to include everything, all the structural elements inside here. So in this one, we have indicated the whole web content will only appear as 80% of this, no matter what device you open. Your website, right, the content will appear as 80%. So you can see actually we have some margin here, right, some space here. So no matter what device you open, it is the width of your content will be 80%. So margin left, margin right, they set to auto, so they will auto configure, depends on the device viewport. Background color, that you can also indicate the background color. So whatever empty space that didn't have main content, didn't have any content or structural elements, will have this background color. So for header, so this is the header with background color indicate here. H1 here with margin and padding, configure margin and padding. So this is for navigation. So you can see here, right, one of the important thing you can see, just now we have mentioned the float property, right? When you design layout, you can use the float property to float your section to left or to right so that you can actually create the column layout, more than the two column layout. So if you see in this example, we float it to the left and we want the size to be 90 pixels. So this is 90 pixels and we also have padding, the 10 pixels padding. We also have padding between the border and also the main context. So another, this is we configure for the main structural elements. Margin left 100 pixels, padding 10, background color. Okay. So for footer also, you can see in the footer we have the text align property to align the text in the center. Style italic, background color is this color, and the background color is same as the header color. You can see that they use the same color code for header and footer. So this is one example to show you the two columns. This is another example of two columns. The navigations is one column. Another column consists of the main part, the header, and the main content and footer. So this is another example of two columns. This one, just separate to navigation and also had a combination of header, main content, and footer. So this is another example of two columns. So sometimes people, they also like to have their website in three column page. So if you want to have three column page, so if you see in this example, they have one header on top, so they divide here to three columns. This is the navigation, then this is the main part, and footer is after main is the footer. So footer is in the middle column. So the left column navigation, right column, they have used the aside. They have used the aside structural elements, which include display to news content. So this is another example that of the layout. So you can see in this example, they have actually to create this, they have float the left column to left the navigation, and with the width 150 pixels. The right column content, this with they float the aside to right. They float this to right side with the width 200. So this you can see actually this is bigger, 200, and this is 150. This is bigger than this. So the rest will automatically appear in the center column. So the center column, right, they also put margin. Okay, margin 0 to 10 pixels for this, they indicate the margin space. Footer, they to clear the float, so that it will they want to clear the float from the the left and right one, so they use the clear property. Okay, so these are just some examples or some idea that how people create different columns layout. Shows you the so if you download the sample course, I have example layout two columns and layout three columns. This is just a reference for you. If you are interested to see how it works, this is at least some sample codes for you to see how they indicate in the CSS. So if I just open the website first to show you how it looks like. So this is one example. We have two columns, header, the one that we have seen in the lecture notes. We have header, navigation, bar on the left, main content on the right, and then we have a footer here. So you can see this is the we have created a division called ID called wrapper to wrap the whole thing together to include all the structural elements. So you can see within the body, right, again we add a wrapper ID. In this division with the ID name the wrapper to wrap the whole body layout for this website. So you can that's why when we have this ID, we include the header, navigation, all the structural elements has been included. Then we have some styles applied to the wrapper, and this will actually reflect to the whole body layout. Okay. So in this example, like what I show you just now, you only cover the 80%. So you can see it won't show the. Now I put into 100%. Just now I didn't zoom 100%. So if you see, when I open on my laptop, these whole things only appear 80%. So if you open in your own laptop, it maybe will look a bit different from my one. So we have margin left, margin right, auto, background color is this color. Okay. So you can see in this example, the one that I've mentioned just now, navigation float to left. That's why it will appear on the left side. So you can see in the home, in the home page navigation appear, because just like we have mentioned, right, they follow the order in the coding. In this example, navigation appear after header. So we can see when we float, right, because it appear after header, so it will only float to the, it will float to the left after the after the web page has displayed the header. So only float to the left and the space. Okay, so this is just to show you an example for the two columns. This is another example for three columns. Just open to show you. Okay, so this is the example that just now we also see that. But this one, we have header and bottom, then we have the left, that float to left, navigation float to left, and another one, the aside float to the right side. And the middle one is the main content and the footer across the three columns. So we see the code in this example. So in this example also, we can see header, we have a wrapper to wrap the whole thing, the whole layout inside the body. And in this example, we have header, we have navigation, we also have aside. So you notice, right, aside actually appear after navigation, not after main. The position set, the order that you put the code also will affect the layout. How you, when you, the positions of your layout. So you can see in this example, we have navigation, then we have the aside, the news division under the aside. So sometimes if you, it doesn't appear like what you want, it also, the order that you have for the coding within your HTML also will affect how the layout looks like. So you can see in this example, we have navigation, then only we, well, then we have aside, then only we have the main content. That's why the main one appear in the middle. And in your CSS rules, okay, we have this one to indicate that we want all the HTML structural elements to display as block. 80%, this is similar to what you have seen, two columns. The one that I would like to highlight is, you can see navigation, float to left, aside, float to right. So it will appear differently. Let me check, let's say if I, okay, so you will see that it shows you the float actually play an important role to for you to create the columns. And the footer, use the clear. This is the one that I mentioned in the lecture notes. They use a clear property to clear the float, so that it appear across the columns. So this is just some of the property that I, just now we also mentioned in the lecture notes, right? So show you to, so that you know how to, how is the effect. So you can, if you are interested to know more, you open the sample code for two columns and three columns layout and understand how it works. You can also play around to see how the effects will change to different layouts. You can also resize the columns, and you can test you can play around with the sample code. Okay, so far before I continue, do you have anything that you are clear or not clear on the page layout? Do you clear with the columns concept, two column or three columns layout, and how it works using the float property? Is it clear or got any problem or not? Okay, thanks Li Chun. So I will continue for the last part of the CSS layout. For you will notice that in CSS, right, we will have a navigation menu. Normally we use the anchor tag to display the menu. By default, we will have underline when it is a navigation link. But if you visit a lot of websites, right, you won't see. If you have any link, right, normally they won't display as the underline. Like for example, in this one, I can only see the underline when I when I have the mouse move on top of it. So because we want to make the everything looks nicer, so one of the practice is we also want to remove the underline, the lines below the navigation link. So how are you going to remove the marker and the underline, the list marker and also the underline? Because normally if you use the bullet points, they will show as the bullet, right? But if you want to remove the list marker, which is the bullet, which are the bullet point and also the underline for the anchor tag, you can use this list style type equals to none to remove the all the marker. So you will, the bullet points gone. For anchor tag, you can use the text decoration property. You can see when you indicate the values here, none, all the lines missing. So you can come back to our sample code. It also here, if let's say if I remove this, right? Now I refresh it again. You can see all the underline appear already. Now I put it, when I put it back and refresh it, all the underline will be missing. Okay, so this is the example for vertical navigations where we use the unordered list to display the navigation link, a navigation menu in vertical order. This is in vertical order, but sometimes you can see some of the website, the navigations actually appear on top here in horizontal navigation as the horizontal navigations. So for this example, in the horizontal, we can also apply the same thing. We can also remove the style, the list marker style. We want to remove the list marker style. We also want to remove the text decoration so that no underline. If you see here, they actually add some padding space on the right. So you can see it before home right. In this navigation, we have a padding right, 10 pixels. And the LI also indicate display this item in line. Okay, this will configure the list item for inline display. So this is the example to show you, and this is the explanations of the effect that you see. You will see that in this CSS rules, we help you to remove the list marker, remove underline, add padding, and configure the list items for inline display. You can see we also have what we call pseudo classes. So for example, in anchor elements, they have what we call pseudo classes. We have some pseudo classes for this anchor element, like we have anchor link. We can also show whether visited or not. If you see that sometimes we click some certain link, right? After you click it, you will change color to another color. So all these visited, or when people focus, or when the mouse move over the hyperlink, or when the hyperlink has focused, or when anyone visited the link, after you click the link visited, we can also have what we call pseudo class to include the property and value to this particular link. So generally, the default state for a hyperlink is we use the link. So the first time that everything appeared, this will be the color. If let's say you want to change, indicate that the color will be changed after people have clicked and visit the link, you can also specify the color, what color you want. Or when people hover, or when it is the hyperlink has focused, or when a link is active or it is being clicked, you can also indicate different property to it. So this is what we mean. There are some pseudo classes for the anchor elements that you can actually indicate it. So if you see this example, the text hyperlinks are underlined by default. So when they apply the CSS to configure, the anchor link color has changed. And also when the mouse hover on top of this link, okay, you can see the color, right? Normally by default, it won't be this color, but now we change the red color already. And the line is underlined by default. But when we when we apply the hover, that means that when the mouse hover on top of this link, we notice that the text decoration, the line is missing, and the color of the links, the text color of this link also changed. So this is the effect. Of the original one, they show it by default, the link is red color with underline. So when my mouse hover on top of it, it changed to the underline is gone, and the color also changed. So this is one of the example to use the pseudo class. So there are also some other things that you can also have. This is the example. You can also have the header. This is an example for header text image replacement. It is useful when a non-web safe font is used in a must be used in a header, logo, banner area. So you can also display the banner image, but configure the text in the H1 for use by search engines. Because sometimes we have a banner or header logo banner area, but at the same time we also indicate some, what we call, we also have some lines, so that this actually will be useful when sometimes some of the text to be recognized by the search engines, they still will include the text, although they have image on top of the text. So you can see in this example, they have configured the placements of the H1 text to be beyond the browser viewport. That means it will be hidden. The text indent is 100%, white space, no wrap, overflow, hidden. So this is one of the example. Although we already have a banner, this is an image, but we still have a H1 within the header, the text. That this is actually, it will be hidden from the user, but will be used by search engines or any technologies to detect our the names or the H1 in our website. So this is if you click the links, then you can see the example. So this is a more explanation. If you are interested, can click and see more. So we also can use CSS to configure position. So these are some position property that you can apply: static, fixed, relative, absolute. So each of the position property will give you different effects. The default one we will use, the value will be static. So if you want to fix the locations of an element, you can use the fixed value. So if you want to fix it, no matter what, which browser, which device that you are going to open, the position will not move, will be fixed. Then you can use the fixed value. Relative, sometimes some of the website, when we want to design it, we want to configure the location of an element relative to where it would otherwise render in the normal flow, we can use the relative value. Or if we want to configure to have the precise, an element outside of normal flow, the locations, then you can also use absolute. So they will give you different effect. Like in this example, this is an example with fixed position. So the navigation bar will stays in place when page is scroll. So no matter when you scroll down the main content, it will still appear. So this is another example for the relative. So this is another example of when we put the position for paragraph as a relative. So the changes of the locations will appear in relation to where it appears. So this is absolute positions. When you apply the absolute position, so this is some of the example you can actually go back and just play around with it. Okay. So this is actually for this lecture, I introduced you with some basic CSS, and in this example is to focus on the box model concept and how we can actually apply the configure the layout using two columns, three columns, using some property like floor and some other properties also will be useful for us to do the positioning for the navigation, or we can also use the CSS pseudo classes concept for elements such as Angkor Thet. They have their own pseudo classes. So if you for these two, right, and if you are new to CSS, you can go online to search more information. The lecture notes basically just cover you some examples of the basic CSS, but there are a lot of properties for different elements, for different HTML elements. You have different set of properties supported by them that you can add your styles to it. For layout also, if you are interested to different kind of layouts, you can go online to search for other examples. In my sample code, I only give you some examples of some of the things, some of the examples that are some of the examples just to give you some idea. If you see here, this is actually the give you some idea on the box model examples and the concept of the viewport. So you can see we have one line right indicate here the viewport, and we scale it to 1. So they are different examples in the box model, how they actually indicate, shows you the how they indicate some of the configure some of the CSS styles. This is another example for display and the CSS that they apply to the display. So you can actually go through some of these examples, and also of course you can always go online to look for more examples. So this one is basically just show you some examples like how is the sizes using the percentages, using the EMs. When you use different units, just now you have seen one of my slides, right? I show that we can actually use different units like to indicate the size, like EMs, pixels, percentages. So this is just to give you some of the examples of or sample code, just to give you some example. And you can just play around with it. So this is another example. So there are a few sample codes that I include here. It's more like just to give you some examples. If let's say you are interested, and you can see that in this example, right? This is this is a flex box example, and they include what we call the Google APIs to use the Google fonts. So this is an example to show. You can also refer to this example under the flex box to see how they actually apply. We have our own customized CSS, but for the font, right, they have applied the. They also include a link to refer to the Google fonts. So sometimes these are just some of the examples to show you some additional examples, just to give you some ideas on the CSS, how you can what are the different versions of CSS configurations that you can do to the website. So they are just additional, but of course if you as long as you can understand the basic one, in future if you use some other framework like Bootstrap, when you look at their CSS file, you already know how they configure their values. If you want to make changes to styles, some styles that you have imported, you will be able to know how to do it. Or when you refer to any example. So the main things that, although what I teach is basic, but it will be useful for you to understand what are the concept that people have applied in the in the style configuration. So when let's say when you see this file, you already know there will be an ID in the HTML page that you can refer to see what is the element that they are referring to. So if you understand all these basic concepts, like when you see any dot, you will know they are referring to a class name. So these are still something that at least when I teach you the basics, at least this will help you to interpret the any sample or any examples that you are referring to. So So you need to at least understand the basic in order for you to know how to do the styles for your website, or even if you refer to some examples and modify it or apply it to your website, it is always good that you understand the CSS concept. Okay, so before I end the class, do you have anything to ask for this lecture on CSS? Yeah, under the image, yeah, we have. So because this the purpose of having the H1 is to so that sometimes your website can be if they extract H1, because they know that H1 normally is used to indicate some main headings or main structure, they some of the main text of the headings of your website, to know the purpose of your website or the name of your website or the company name. So sometimes some of the search engine, they actually will try to crawl the information, the H1 values from your website. So any other things for when you go home, for those, especially for those who have new to CSS, try to do the lab. In the lab, I give you the instructions. When you download the file, I also give you a zip folder with all the images. So when you download the image, these are the images that you can use in the website. And this is the instruction. So these are some of the I give you some instructions to how to configure the CSS file for Java Jam. So when you follow the instructions from your previous work, right, you save it as you move all the files to a new folder for Java Jam 2. Then you also copy the new image files into your new folder. And I try to give you some instructions to let you practice how to configure the external CSS. So you have to open a new file and save it as javajam.css, then try to practice and learn and look at how to do the configurations. I give you the examples here, but of course later when you do it for your own website, you can change it again. You can try to understand in my descriptions, I try to explain to you what you are configuring. So all these have to include inside your javajam.css. So for every web page, sometime after that, I also ask you to add some additional CSS into the javajam.css. So to include it, remember to add this into the header. Into the head section, sections, you need to include the link to refer to the CSS. So it should look like this. Okay, this is you may look the output may look the website may look a bit different. It depends on the viewport of your website. So this is when I open here, this is how it looks like. Okay, so you can go back and try and see how to design. So the colors, all these are, I just recommended to, we just try, do it as a practice and to let you try it, to at least you see how it works for a typical website when we include the CSS. So if you have time, if you have additional time, you also can try to practice to convert it to a two-column page layout. You can refer to the simple codes that I give you and convert the file. If you have time, like additional time, you want to convert to two columns. So this is an example. Convert the navigation to left column, and this is the main content. So this is more like exercise for you to practice on this website. You can go back and try it. Okay, so anything else you want to ask? For the assignment, right, I will check how is the group. For those students that don't have the group yet, you have to click this link to look at what project titles or which teams, because some of the team, I think they will indicate that they still need members, or if you don't have a team yet, please contact. And for these groups, right, can you add the bracket who will be the leader of this team? If anything, at least I can contact the leader. Please update the page with the leaders to let me know who will be the leader for this team. So the last thing is I have sent the invitations for the AWS Academic Portal. This will be the individual assignment for you as part of your alternative assessment to replace your final exam. So this will contribute 20% to your marks for the alternative assessment. I have invited all the students, but if you haven't received my invitation, because some students I know you registered late, if you didn't receive my invitation yet, please let me know so that I can add you. So far, there are a few students that haven't accepted my invitations. So if you are here, please accept my invitation. And for the student who have received my invitation, please change your name, update your name on your profile. Because when I create, right, there are so many students, so I'm lazy to add your name one by one. You can update your profile because the name, your name that will appear when you claim the badge, they will actually retrieve it from your profile. So update your name on the profile, because when I add it, right, by default, if I didn't enter any name, they will use your email address as your name, but you can actually update your name on your profile. So for the students that didn't receive my invitation yet, please I resend it again and accept my invitation, and you can start following the online lectures, go through the modules. So if you want to get full marks, make sure you complete all the knowledge tests and all the labs. So after you complete and for knowledge check, you have to score at least 80%. Then after you complete it, you can claim your badge here. So after you claim your badge, right, email your PDF versions of your badge and the certificate of completion to me, so that I can keep a copy for and give you marks. Okay. No question, right? Any question? If you have any question, you can still ask me during the lab session. So if no question, then I will end the class now. I'll stop the recording. Okay, it's 1 p.m. now. Bye, take care.